But the pressure that's put on you now is to keep you out of the hell. If you're suffering now, it's because you choose to suffer. The word is clear. The guidance is clear. Stop all the scheming in your household, scheming in your neighborhood, you know, scheming all the time, whispering, backbiting all the time. Cut that foolishness out and let us start it right here with the Shura. Now I'm turning around pointing to him. Huh? Let us start it right here. Stop this foolishness. Let us support thee, ma'am. Let's get real with this. Let us hear and obey. That's what we need to do. Obey God. Obey his messenger and those charged with authority over you. I did read that in Arabic. I'm the law. Imam W.D. Muhammad. Takbir! Takbir! Takbir!
Praise be to Allah. Praise be to Allah. Praise be to Allah. Thank you, sir. Praise be to Allah, for Imam. For Imam. Praise be to Allah. Praise be to Allah. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Praise be to Allah. Thank you. Praise be to Allah. Dear Muslims, dear believers, friends, and our honorable guests, all, we greet you with the Muslims' greetings, a greetings of peace, wishing peace be to you, be extended to you, and wishing that peace be accepted by you. We say, Assalamu alaikum. Peace be upon you. We thank Allah, the one Lord over the heavens and the earth and everything there is, who created everything, and who made excellent the human creature and gave us the most excellent models as leaders and examples to us, his servants, the messengers and prophets of the scripture, and the best of them, the last of them, the completion of the human excellence that God intended for all people. Muhammad, the Prophet, upon him be the prayers and the peace. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa ba'd. Before going to my typed notes here that I hope will guide me and keep me from talking too long, a little boy who just made 6 years old, July 6, 1996, not too long ago. He told me, he said, are you gonna talk long? So I said, I don't know. I said, should I talk long? He didn't reply right away. I say, should I talk a little or talk a lot? He hesitated. He said, talk a little and talk a lot. So I told him I understood. And I'm going to try to do that. But before I begin this address, I have to have some comments. First of all, on the people of this community, you, many of you who came to the Quran, though you didn't pick it up or touch it because you weren't invited to do that, but you did accept that the Quran was the holy sacred book and not the Bible. You did that in the early 30s, through the 30s, through the 40s, through the 50s, through the 60s, through the 70s, until 1975, February 26th, when Allah brought change about, and I became your leader by your consent. Praise be to Allah. So I have to say something about you. I have observed you all over all the years of my life. As a little fella, I was attracted to look at the followers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. To look at your faces, to look at your expressions, to listen to what you had to say. When you were socializing and when you were listening to the Honorable Elijah Muhammad or talking about the teachings, I had an ear that wanted to hear what you were saying, your expressions. And I believe Allah has made me to know you very well. And today in White Plains, New York, for our 1996 Islamic Convention, I want to say to you, I'm very happy, I'm very pleased with you, I'm very proud of you. Praise be to Allah. I've seen this following start out in a very honest and sincere way. Very religious, strongly believing in a God, believing that we were true Muslims, believing that we had the real Islam. And I've seen us change from that sincerity, from that religious character, to a black image character during the 60s, the last half of the 60s and the 70s, and the early 70s. And I thank Allah that now after 20 years, we are coming back, we have come back to the sincerity, to the religious character. We have a good spirit now, the spirit of the following is the spirit of God-fearing people, the spirit of Muslims. We still have a long ways to go for the many of us to come into the rational mind of the good Muslim. To have the rational mind of the good Muslim, we have to have the knowledge for our intelligence, the knowledge for our brain that God has given to us in the last revelation, the Quran, and in the teachings and example of the Prophet, the last and seal of the prophets, Muhammad. When we get that knowledge, we don't all have to become scholars, but there is some simple basic knowledge for our brain, for our reasoning that we need to have so that we will be also Muslim believers in our rational makeup, in our rational makeup. Right now, majority of us, our rational minds accept but don't know. Accept but don't know. We don't want to live in the dark. We want to live in the light of faith, and in the light of ilm, knowledge in Islam. So I encourage you who are thinking not only for yourself or yourselves, but you are thinking for the good of this whole people, the whole community, I encourage you to continue to study studiously the Quran as a rational person and as a person of faith. Continue to study hard, qualify more, improve your language, your Arabic, lugatul Arabiyya, improve the Arabic language so that you will be able to read the Quran and understand it in the Arabic script, the Arabic text, so that we will have better qualified leaders to bring our people forward more and more, not only into the spiritual side of the religion or the disbelief, but the knowledge itself, the logic, the rational teachings, the rational guidance, etc. This is a must. Our guest from Malaysia, Dr. Muhammad Minuti, is a brother that I met, brother in Islam that I met in Malaysia as his guest, as a guest of his organization, the Muslim Youth of Malaysia, or ABIM. And I went there really because I had met many Malaysian Muslims over the years that I have been serving this community. And they all, each one, encouraged me to want a visit to Malaysia. And more than half of them invited me to come to Malaysia. And I'm sure that all of them, each of them, would want me, would have wanted me, and still would want me to visit Malaysia. So I went to Malaysia mainly because of the impression I had of Malaysia from Malaysians that I had met, Muslims that I had met in this country. But when I learned of the organization, the Muslim Youth Organization, and learned of the principle of tolerance or accommodation and tolerance that the leader of ABIM just shared with us, I was even more excited about the visit because I wanted to see very much that society that took the position that I feel very much convinced that Muhammad the Prophet took, prayers and peace be upon him, and that was the position of a person totally devoted to God and rational. If we can't understand our leaders and follow our leaders with our good common senses, with the brain that God put in our heads, something's wrong with those leaders. I will not follow any leader just with my heart or just with my spirit. If I can't follow him with the common senses that God gave me, I'm going to follow somebody else, look for somebody else to follow. And I believe Prophet Muhammad is, importantly for us and the world, the prophet that was established upon the excellent intelligence or the excellent rational mind of the human person, and at the same time, the excellence of faith. Both. He was established in the excellence of faith and also in the excellence of intelligence, human intelligence, a rational mind. And because of that, he is the last prophet and the last example to us. He didn't just represent that, he applied it. He applied it for the establishment of the Ummah, the Muslim community in Medina, the first government of Islam. He applied it for the establishment of the Muslim Ummah. He applied it for good relationship with non-Muslim nations. Do you know Prophet Muhammad had good relationship with Christian Ethiopia of Africa, First Nation? They didn't believe, they weren't Muslims, but he had good relationship with them. And he had good relationship with really the Christians of Europe. And you read the Quran, God revealed the religion to Prophet Muhammad and recognized the excellence of the followers of Jesus Christ. Even though we are told by God that they have strayed and most of them are corrupt, but a few of them are believers, and they want to see advance the same good that the Muslim wanted, or the Ummah should be devoted to advancing, the same good. So God pointed that out to us, and because of that, the early Muslim Ummah had good relationship with the Christians, most of them. And the early Ummah, the early community under Muhammad the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the prayers and the peace be upon him, in its earliest days, it had extended the hand of friendship, accommodation, and tolerance to the Jewish community of Medina. But the Jewish community, there were elements in the Jewish community who were devils. They were Satans. They were the followers of Satan. There were elements in the Jewish community of Medina who were devils, and they helped create hypocrites in the ranks of the believers, caused a lot of trouble, instigated a lot of trouble for the Muslims within the ranks of the Muslims, and also with other people, other tribes that hadn't converted to Islam, etc. So then the separation came, separating the Muslims from the Jews. But never has the God said in the Quran that all Jews are bad. Never has the Prophet roused his community to hate Jews per se. Never. And in our Quran, God tells us of the Jews too. Say there, most of them are corrupt. God, I bear witness. Most Christians are corrupt. I bear witness, God. Most of the people who call themselves Christians, they are corrupt. And I bear witness, God, most people who call themselves Jews, they are corrupt. And God, I bear witness that most people who call themselves Muslims, they are corrupt. I bear witness, God. I am a witness. Yes. So I'm attracted to the people of Malaysia, mainly because of what the Muslim government stands for there, and because of their support for that Muslim government, the support of the non-Muslims for the Muslim government of Malaysia. I'm attracted to that country. And I hope that we'll have another visit soon to Malaysia and follow up on the proposal that we presented when we were there to Abim, the president of Abim, and the other, the secretary general of Abim, and to the deputy prime minister, who used to be the deputy prime minister, second man in the power structure, or in the political power structure of Malaysia. The deputy prime minister used to be a student of Abim, and also an officer of Abim. I met him, very wonderful person, who one day be the prime minister, number one man, we think. And it could come soon, we don't know. Next election, who knows, if he chooses a campaign for that position. But we are satisfied with him as number two man. We'd be satisfied with him if he was number 10 man. The wonderful person, and we are happy to know that such persons are in the top leadership of the government, and the Muslims are making such wonderful contribution, not only to the good life and stability of the Muslim community, of the Muslims of the Malaysian community, but also they are making that contribution to all the citizens of Malaysia, whether they belong to one religion or another, or whether they belong to one nationality or another. This is wonderful. I didn't believe that there, I didn't think that there was a Muslim country on this earth today that had such an open mind, open policy toward the public in general, and had such a pluralistic makeup in its citizenry. So this is wonderful. I'm very excited about our future relations with the people, especially the ABIM, this Muslim organization, and with the establishment of the Malaysian people. We hope to have an association with them. We hope to even work on dawah materials with them. Myself, with their learned people, some of their learned people, some of our other imams, our learned imams, will also be working, inshallah, with some of their learned people to put out materials jointly, authored by a Malaysian and also by an African-American Muslim. That's what we hope. And we also hope that we will benefit from their institutions of learning, especially the International University, Islamic University in Malaysia. And the mosque there, beautiful, very beautiful too. You would just love the visit if you weren't going there for any other purpose but to sightsee, go sightseeing. You would love the visit. It would be more than worth your ticket just to go there for sightseeing, especially if you're a Muslim. But there are so many other benefits that you can get just by going there. And we hope that one day we will benefit from the institutions of learning. We hope that we'll also benefit from a study of their culture, of the Malaysian people's culture, how the different ethnic groups and the different people with different cultures and different cultural backgrounds, pardon me, how they are living together in peace and working for one nation, the one country, Malaysia. We want that in America, and we're getting it. It's coming gradually because most Americans now of good minds who are leading their people, they are supporting that. The President Clinton, and his address, one of his addresses that he made at the convention, the Democratic convention, he stressed inclusion. And that's what we have to do. We have to recognize that all people were created by Allah, and if he created them, he must love all of them. And he created them for the same thing he created all of us for. He created all people for the good destiny, that Allah has made possible for his human creatures. So we cannot take any people out of the humanity, and we can't take any people out of the competition for the good life that God wants for all of us. So let us compete in the spirit of brothers and sisters in humanity, brothers and sisters in humanity, if not as brothers and sisters in religion. Let us compete as brothers and sisters in humanity and pray that we all will one day be brothers and sisters in religion, if God wills that. So I would like to say much more about our interest in a relationship, a real lasting relationship that will be carried on by our sons and their sons and our sons and daughters for generations and generations to come. Something that we want with Malaysia to be eternal, if it can be, at least perpetual. We want it to be perpetual, not ending, not ceasing, not stopping. We don't want to ever break the relationship that we are trying to form with the people of Malaysia. I believe it is very important in the future of the Muslim community here to have that relationship with the people of Malaysia, with the Muslim, particularly with ABIM, this group. I also have to say that the imam of this New York area, Imam Pasha, He has more than earned the recognition that the Shura gave to him. Man of the year. I have watched him and been in close contact with him, hearing him from him by phone, by mail, letters, etc. And when I saw New York Times put an article on him as the imam of the Malcolm Shabbat Mosque, a masjid, on the front page of New York Times, in a pious position, sitting down in Salat, I said to myself, if he didn't achieve anything but that, or if Allah didn't grant him anything but that, he have achieved more than most of us have achieved in all the cities of the United States with our hard work, our dawah. Because that picture went all throughout New York State, and America, U.S., and outside of the U.S. New York Times is no cheap media. It's thought of as number one newspaper in the United States. Yes. So that was a great, great recognition that we appreciate so much. And we appreciate the Times for having that interest and putting the imam on the front page. Now, he didn't hit it once. He was in it more than once. He was in the New York Times. And I mean given prominence in the paper. They are very obviously appearing there, writing in pictures. And on the real practical side, not Islam now, but just recognition for what he had done in a very practical way. He has made a real physical imprint on the environment there that where the Malcolm Shabazz was. I go to the area now, it looks cleaner. It looks more progressive. The vacant lot has a market there named for Malcolm Shabazz Market. The peddlers, I used to be one myself. I know how difficult it is to peddle, to sell goods on the streets, especially if you are truly a natural human. It's very difficult. He took them out of one situation. They thought they were going to lose. They thought they were getting in a worse situation. Or we can't sell on the streets. We can't sell in front of the retail stores. Or they were upset, and they were thinking that, we're being betrayed. But the result has been that they have been able to earn money just like they did before. And those who are really working hard in that market, they're earning more than they did before. And not only are they earning more money, but the revenue to the city now is making the city feel very grateful to the work of Imam Pasha, the leadership of Imam Pasha. And then I read in the New York paper of Imam Pasha, this writer was saying that not since Malcolm X has there been a leader for the African Americans of Harlem. They're pointing to him as the first one that is making an impression on the community there and environment there, in that environment, convincing them that maybe the blacks now, maybe the African Americans of Harlem have a leader that they can trust again. Praise be to Allah. This is wonderful. So I wouldn't have felt that I had taken care of what I should take care of here today without mentioning that. And again, as I have much more to say about Dr. I'm Muhammad A. Manudi. I have much more to say about Imam Pasha, but I'll try to do what my little friend said, that little six-year-old. Talk a little and talk a lot. This is our annual convention, 1996. National Islamic Convention. You know, we used to, when we thought we were the wisest and the truest of Muslims, we used to have national convention. It was called Savior's Day. The national Savior's Day meeting. And it meant a lot to us. It meant a lot to our spirit. It meant a lot to us for our unity. It meant a lot to us for our sense of belonging to each other. Our temples, they were called back then. And later, our mosques. We had a greater sense of oneness and brotherhood, fraternal bonds, because of that annual day, once a year. And I've had them tell me, some of them, they would tell me, I've heard them say in my presence, and also I've been told, say, well, I live for this day. Say, every time I come to the fountain, I go back and I keep it for a year, for a whole year. It lasts me for a whole year. What I'm seeing now in the last few years of our national convention, that the same thing is happening again. I find myself given a spirit that doesn't die, it lives in me until the next convention. Yes. When I came here to this convention, I came here still with me, the spirit, the excitement, the enthusiasm, the good results that I got from the previous convention. God has given us this. When God gave us the Eid al-Adha, where Muslims from all over the world go to Mecca to visit the ancient house, the first house built for mankind to the worship of one God, the Kaaba there. When we go there once a year, we get something that lasts us a lifetime, really. A lifetime. But God has it open to us through his servant and messenger, Muhammad. It has been established for us as a yearly visit. And believe me, I'm proud to say that we got a few in our community that go to the Hajj every year. And they are not rich, they are poor. They're poor, but they're fortunate. One of them have relatives working for the airlines, and they got such good benefits, they don't worry. They travel, they get on a plane anytime they want and go wherever they want to go. That's a great blessing from Allah. But many of you, if you had a ticket to go to Hajj every day, you still wouldn't make it. So these are outstanding people we are talking about, who have an opportunity to make the Hajj, and they are making it every year. This national convention is very important for us. Very, very important for us. If you can go and vacation for a week or a few days on the weekend to one of the vacation sites in the United States for nothing but a little relief from the pressures that's on you, you should feel much more obligated to make a family sacrifice if you have to. Allah will recover what you lost, will more than pay you back what you spend, so that you will be present for these annual conventions. It's very important that the small number of Muslims in America come together in as big a numbers as possible in the public of the United States so that America will know that real Muslims are here in America. We're also grateful to this town, this big little town, White Plains, New York, for its warmth, its hospitality that it had extended to Muslims. And it's not Muslim, it's Christian. And it's Jewish. And it's something else, others, I don't know. But I know Muslims are a kind of strange visitor in this town of White Plains. They don't see Muslims around here. But they'll know from now on, Muslims. And they'll be telling their friends, oh, don't tell me about those, don't tell me about the Muslims unless you know what you're talking about. Those people came to our town in White Plains. Well, I feel very good. And I prepared some notes and I came here to address you. But God is my witness, highly glorified is he. God is my witness. If I know you want to say amen or amen and go to the next program, I'm ready to do it with you. Because we have had some very valuable words shared with us today, given to us, extended to us today, from our honorable guests from Malaysia, and also from our very lively Imam, Imam Pasha. So, but I will see, can I really finish this up for that young fella? Let me say this. Most of us who followed the Honorable Elijah Muhammad were not expected to know exactly what was happening to us. We were not expected to know what was happening to our minds in that learning environment, strange learning environment, we call the Nation of Islam in the wilderness of North America, are the holy temples of Islam. We were not supposed to understand what was happening to our minds. We were not supposed to understand what was happening to our spirit. No, we were not supposed to understand it. It was a plan. It was like a prescription from a spiritual doctor to get us into something and hold us by powerful attraction until the grip of Christianity was broken and until the grip of servitude to white authority was broken. That's what it was intended for. But we were not supposed to understand it. Wasn't expected to understand it. It was too high above our head. The scheme, the formula, whatever we want to call it, the scheme or the formula for bringing us out of the clutches of Christianity, out of the clutches of the church, out of the clutches of the white man, it was too high above our level of learning for us to understand it. Majority of us came from not only the people who were poor in their pockets, but also poor in their heads. African Americans first got acquainted with Muslims in the late 20s and in the early 30s. The first to introduce Muslims to African Americans was Honorable Noble Drew Ali. He started the Moorish Science Temple. There's a similarity between the two. You can see it right now. He identified as Muslim, but called the place of worship a temple. That was before Farad came. Then Mr. Farad came, and he did the same thing. He called the houses of worship, or the places of worship, temples. And he gave them numbers. The first one, temple number one, Detroit, Michigan. Then they went from Detroit to Chicago, and they set up the second temple, number two, in Chicago. Even while Farad was here, they went to the third one. Went to Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and set up the third one in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. All the temples after that were established without the presence of W. Farad Muhammad, under the leadership of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad went to Washington, D.C. himself and visited the homes of African-American Christians and found a friend, Brother Benjamin, and his wife, Sister Clara. Found a friend there in Washington that welcomed, opened the doors of their private home, said, "You can stay with us." Said, "Where are you living? You paying the hotel? Don't pay no hotel bill. Stay with us." Honorable Elijah Muhammad was looking for a private home to stay in. So Brother Benjamin and his wife, Sister Clara, and by the way, my mother's name is Clara, the wife of Honorable Elijah Muhammad's Clara, who passed away about 1972, I think. The home was open, and temple number four started right in that home. Temple number four, Washington, D.C., started right in that home. Honorable Elijah Muhammad built up a following there, and eventually, before Malcolm, when Malcolm came, he had number five, number six, number seven, and I believe number eight. Yes, I believe so, number eight. He had these temples. Malcolm came, he was so energetic, new blood in the ministry, energetic, a young man who was current. See, the old ministers, the majority of them, they weren't current. They could hardly tell you what happened in the news today. They only could tell you what Isaiah said. They could tell you what Ezekiel said. The Bible. They were Bible people. But they couldn't tell you what happened in the news today. Malcolm came, and he wasn't a Bible man. He wasn't from that kind of orientation, that Christian orientation or church orientation. He came from the streets. So he was in touch with what was happening in the public life. And because he was better suited for introduce the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's works to the public than those ministers that he called too conservative. I don't agree with him. He became too radical too. So I don't agree with him. But I appreciate him for his contribution to the works of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Not any one single person ever contributed more to the works of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad than did Malcolm X or Malik Shabazz. Getting back to the history, a few years after Noble Drew Ali, in the early 30s, a man more unorthodox and more strange than was Drew Ali, or more of a stranger in the Muslim population of the world than was Noble Drew Ali, Mr. Farad. He came and began introducing the African Americans of Detroit, the poor, the most deprived, culturally and in every other way, of the citizens, African-American citizens of Detroit. He went to them. He didn't go to the intellectuals. He could have sought them out. He didn't seek out the African-American intellectuals. He went to those who suffered the greatest losses in white society. And he went to them and introduced himself and began preaching. And I must say, repeat to you, or say it again, what he came with as Islam was very, very strange in the Islamic world. The Islamic world had never heard of anything like that. They couldn't believe it. And many of them now, they read the papers, they can go back and get Detroit papers that will tell them about Farrakhan. If you can't get it from the Detroit newspaper, go to the police department. And the police department will share with you its records. And you will see W.D. Farrakhan, Mr. W.D. Farrakhan, picture on the newspapers back there, in the newspapers, being arrested. And the charges against him. You will see that. You'll see his picture in their newspapers. And he was their leader, not Elijah Muhammad. Now, I don't know why Muslims outside of America, especially those who propagate the religion or who devote themselves to the teaching of the religion, just won't accept that Elijah Muhammad had a teacher from outside America that claimed to be a Muslim and claimed to be from Mecca, teach him what he was taught and establish him, appointed him to be the leader, and left him with the problems. I don't know why they can't accept that. That's the fact. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad was the son of a Baptist minister, a small, small Baptist minister from Georgia, my grandfather, called William Poole, later Wali Muhammad. He was the son of that Baptist minister. He wasn't a church-going son. He disagreed with the preaching of the preachers. He was what you would call a black sheep in the family. He rather spent his time out on the streets with his buddies, laughing and talking and drinking, than to go to the church. That was the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. But not a bad man. Never was he arrested for stealing or doing anything like, no. Not a bad man, but just an African-American that couldn't find no comfort in the church. The way they were preaching. I'll be like Muhammad, I heard him say with his own mouth. He said, I couldn't accept the way they were preaching the Bible. Meant that he thought it should have been preached differently. So he finally met a man who agreed with him. Say, this is wrong. He accepted that man. And that man gave him something he called Islam. And Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he never hardly got out of Georgia except to come to the factories of Detroit looking for a better financial situation for himself and his big family. He never knew anything about Muslims. He never knew any Muslims. So here's his first contact with Muslims, somebody calling themselves Muslim. First time. He knew about Noble Drew Ali, but he wasn't following Drew Ali, as some of them think. I met some of that leader, and they say, your father was a member of our Moor Science Temple first. We know it because that's our fez on his head. Farrakhan called his temples, or his places, temples after Drew Ali. And he also gave his first followers, the men, a fez like Drew Ali wore. That doesn't mean that they were Moorish American. No, Farrakhan just used that. He used what Drew Ali had used. Yes. So the Honorable Elijah Muhammad didn't know anything about Islam. When the Honorable Elijah Muhammad went to prison, for refusing to fight for the country or take out or have a graph card. Just register with this country in its war against the Japanese and the Germans in World War II. But Honorable Elijah Muhammad refused. When he went to prison, he didn't know anything about no real Islam. When Farad introduced Islam to him, he introduced something that was so, I would say, different. I know the words to use, but I have to use the words that you can accept. He introduced something that was so different that it completely engaged and occupied every brain cell in his head. So he could read a book later. Now he's been introduced to Islam. You think he's going to go and say, let me find a book on Islam and read it? If he found one by accident and he picked it up, he ain't going to read nothing but Yaqub history in that book. I don't care what it says on this in its language. I don't care how straight his language is. When he read it, it's going to support Yaqub's history. It's going to support the black man being God. Because what Farad gave him was so different, it had such a powerful hypnotic effect on him that he couldn't see nothing beyond that. And if you said this is a Muslim, he saw one agreeing with him. And if he didn't, he condemned that person. You don't understand Islam yet, brother. I don't care if you're from Al-Azhar in Egypt. I've seen them do this. I don't care if you had 50 years study in Al-Azhar in Egypt. You don't have the real Islam, brother. Why don't you let me teach you? So Farad has some powerful medicine. Powerful magnetism. You know, he told us that the white man's world began with the interest in magnetic power. Right? He was hinting that he's going to begin his world too. In us, with the same interest in magnetic power. I'm going to create something with such a powerful attraction that it's going to be like a powerful magnet. It's just going to bring them to it, and they ain't going to be able to break from it. A review of that time back then, 1930s, late 20s, 1930. It's almost a must for us who want to better prepare ourselves to invite not only those who were in the Nation of Islam or in the temples of Islam like we were. In fact, I was born in that. I was born in it. I was born October 30, 1933. And my father was following Farad at that time, and Farad was present at that time. And my mother was a devout follower of his at that time. And they remained so. So I know. I was born in it. And if the imams were with me, if you want to be better qualified to invite African Americans to Islam, even if they haven't been converted to the Nation of Islam or the temples of Islam, you need to go back and become acquainted with what was happening in the religious atmosphere of that time, the late 20s, the early 30s, and for a time after. Why do I say that is very important? It is very important because African Americans, whether they have turned their attention to the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad or not, you have been affected by the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. You may be Catholic, you may be Protestant, you may be Holy Roller, I don't care what you are. Your mind has been affected by the presence of that little powerful black man, Elijah Muhammad, in America. Yes? Whether you're conscious of it or not, the way you're thinking have been somewhat shaped by the presence of Elijah Muhammad in America. And if we are going to bring you forward into better life and a better condition, we who want to do that or assume that responsibility, we should really study those times that Farad came into. During that time, the late 20s and early 30s, and a kind of apocalyptic air had been created. By apocalyptic, we're talking about prophecies, preachers, those scholars, interested persons in Christianity, in religion, where it is taking us, what it says about the beginning of things and the end of the world. Those people were excited. Their minds and intellects were excited in the late 20s and the early 30s, very much excited. They thought that 1914 should have been the end of the world. Not the Temple of Islam, not Drew Ali, not the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Christians. It was published in their papers. You just go get the papers. All this can be verified. That's one thing good about America. They record practically everything. All of this can be verified. So the Christian mood and the Christian spirit was the spirit of people that had been touched by apocalyptic prophecies, apocalyptic teachings in Christianity. And they thought that the world would have come to an end in 1914. But it didn't. That didn't make them believe any less that the world was near its end. They still believed it. And they thought it was coming in any day, at any time. And Farad comes at that time. He, not that he'd come, he was already there. But he comes to the mind. He comes into the mind that I can do this thing. There was a report in the Detroit area by people, and the press reported what they said of a spacecraft appearing over Michigan, the state of Michigan. Not hearsay, these are newspaper reports, say that it appeared so big that people described it as a city in the sky. This is the press, Detroit press. They described it as, say it appeared so big it was like a city in the sky. Now this is happening while Farad is thinking about how to do something here. I'm familiar with the Bible. I know about Prophet Ezekiel in the Bible. I know about the Ezekiel wheel in the Bible. And that was there many, many generations, hundreds of years, before those people looked up there and saw a wheel in the sky. So Farad knew too about the Bible. So he told African Americans that craft, that spacecraft that the people say they saw, the Japanese built that. In 1919, I think he said, way back there, somewhere back, 1919, I think it was. In 1919. Now, you know, could tell them anything. Half of them couldn't read newspapers. They weren't literate. And the majority of them couldn't afford a radio. No news. The only time they got the news is when they were told to go to jail. All right. Henry Ford, also back there at that time. Henry Ford, now this would have missed all of us, but it wouldn't have missed Farrar. Henry Ford was pointing the finger at the Jews and accusing the Jews of being people that you can't trust. And American government had better watch them. And at the same time, Adolf Hitler was rising up in Germany. And at the same time, an atheistic idea that said, forget about God, let's build a material society. A society based upon the dynamics of materialism. Communist, Marxist idea. It was rising too, during the same time. So Farrar didn't come in a time when everybody was content to believe that there's God. He came in a time when there was a great number of people on this earth questioning, is there a God at all? And should we listen to religion at all? The communist Marxists and those who followed that idea, they were calling religion the dope, drug. For the masses of people. That's the time that Farrar came into. And there were many Christian writers, or theologians, learned people in the Christian religion. They were questioning the nature of the governments, and if those governments were really the governments that people should support. And they were preaching that the real kingdom is coming, is near. And the people should get ready for the new kingdom, the promised kingdom. They were preaching the end of the world. The end of the world. This is the time that Farrar came in. Right there in Detroit area, there were African-American church leaders preaching strange teachings to African-American people. Many of you perhaps still know about Father Divine. Father Divine was popular on this East Coast, right? Philadelphia. But he also was popular in the Midwest, Detroit and Chicago. He was popular. He had a following there. And Father Divine told his people to look, if they want to see God, to look to him. He was a black man. And he said, if you want to see God, look to me. And he called himself Father Divine. So Farrar came into this kind of atmosphere. This is the kind of atmosphere he came into. This is the kind of language environment that he came into. Now can you understand him coming up with his strange ideas? I think I would have come up with some strange ideas if I had been back there in that time thinking of trying to find a way to awake people's minds. I might have come up with a strange idea like that myself. I don't know if God hadn't guided me. We are trying to present to you knowledge of environment and things that were happening in the environment, so that you will be able to understand the rise of our community, the great role of Islam in the rise of our community. Mr. Farhat comes in and he introduces the sacred book of all Muslims to us. The Quran that he left with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is the same Quran that is with us now, same one read by Muslims all over this world ever since the time of Muhammad the Prophet. Or I should say recited by them and studied by them. Ever since the time of Muhammad the Prophet, prayers and peace be on him, it's the same Quran. The only thing that was different was it was translated into English by teachers, leaders, scholars of the Ahmadiyya movement. Of the Ahmadiyya movement. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad had Muhammad Ali's translation of the Quran translated by the Ahmadiyya Anjuman, the Ahmadiyya movement, based in Lahore, Pakistan at that time. And I think it still is, but they're outlawed, they can't preach publicly. That was the Holy Quran he had. But as for the Arabic, it was the same, no different. In fact, I have one at home. I can pick it up and read the same. It's the Quran, that's what it was. So here the Quran was put into our midst by the hand of Mr. Farah. He introduced it as the book that God approves. That's what he told the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. He said, not the Bible. The Bible is not a holy book. I'm giving you what he said. He said, the Bible is a poison book. He said, this is the holy book, the Quran. But did he tell him to study it so that he can teach it? No. He told him, brother, don't you worry about teaching this book. He said, your children, your sons, would learn, they'll learn, and they will teach it later. So the Honorable Elijah Muhammad respected the book so much, he hung it on the wall. I was a little boy, but I've seen it. I can see it right now in a shiny material, green, kind of light green color, real, almost Kelly green, real life green, with straps. And the straps were like a purse, the Quran inside, were hung over a nail on a molding near the top of the ceiling, hung high. Yes, it hung high in the home of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Before he even had a house, apartment, living, renting, apartment. A lot of you don't know that. You think the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was born with a Mercedes-Benz. He was born with poverty, in poverty, and with poverty on him. And most of his children, we knew poverty. And we still know poverty. Yes, praise be to Allah. Look at that beautiful audience out there. Turn around and look. Let's turn around and turn around. Look back there. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. See, that's what happens when you get your soul right. Our guest, our honorable guest, what did he say? He said, Allah says, he ain't gonna change the conditions for people outside until they change the conditions within themselves. So as our interior has gotten better, God has rewarded us more. And the more we get better internally, the more God is going to reward us externally. Allahu Akbar. So Mr. Farrar definitely wanted us to revere the Quran. He wanted us to respect it as the holy and pure book. Not only did he want us to respect it as the holy and pure book, he wanted us to want that book. How do we know it? From his own words in his own writings. He said, whoever can solve this problem, his reward will be a holy Quran Sharif. That's what he said. So he tempted us to try to solve the mystery in his own language. And he said, if we are able to solve the mystery in his language, our reward will be the Quran. I solved the mystery, and my reward has been the Quran. Praise be to Allah. Now, so, you know, all you have to do, most of us have seen a picture of Farrar. If you haven't seen one, even though you're with me and you don't agree with Farrakhan's leadership, I give you permission to go visit Farrakhan and look on their walls and see the picture of Mr. Farrar. And you'll see him holding the Quran with in a pose that says, this book, I love it. This book, I humble myself to it. Very pious pose, he's holding it, looking very sincere, very pious, very respectful of the book. Now, there's a lot I can say to you all, and I think you ministers, oh, I'm sorry, you imams, I think you know that. Now they know I love them. Now they are better than those that didn't have any appreciation for any scripture. Now, it is my belief that he put the sacred book among us, calling us Muslims. And by placing the Quran in the context of his own experiment, understand this, in his own experiment with abstract reasoning, Now, I have to explain this to most of you, but there are among you many in the audience and behind me who understand abstract reasoning. Abstract reasoning uses concretes to talk about that is not concrete. Uses physical thing like this to talk about something that's not physical. So it will use a physical thing to talk about your spirit, physical thing to talk about your moral life, a physical thing to talk about your mentality or your mental makeup. It will use physical things to talk about things that are not tangible, not touchable, not physical. So this is abstract reasoning. I may say to you that a lot of esoteric language is has abstract reasoning. Metaphysics, abstract reasoning, metaphysics. These languages that uses a material address the non-material are using abstract reasoning, if it follows some kind of logic. Now, Farrar said, Islam is mathematics. His words, not my words, not Elijah Muhammad's word, my father's word, his word. He said, Islam is mathematics. Well, I just go and study mathematics. If I'm going to take him literally, Islam is mathematics, well, you keep the Quran. I'm going to study mathematics. Something in us told us that there was more to understand than what was reaching the ear. See, human beings are not completely without brains, even though they've been deprived. of having contact with education or exposed to education. They have some brains. So something in us, and we have a human soul. That's what's important. Something in us told us, we can't understand this. It sounds good. So we just followed it rhythmically. Rhythmically. Like you dance to the music. We followed it rhythmically. It sound good from this man who said we are black and superior, period. Sound good from the man who said we are black and God in our state that we were in. So this sounds so good, you can say snails eating raw is delicious. Yes, sir. Praise be to Allah. Snakes make the best bed partners. Sleep with snakes. Yes, sir. Praise be to Allah. You couldn't hear anything wrong from a man that said so much in such a powerful way to you to make you feel good about yourself. You couldn't hear anything. Nothing he said out of his mouth would have been wrong. He couldn't say anything stupid. Four men met up in the mothership. A plane with a wheel and a wheel. They went up in 1919, they're still up there. No toilets and no food. Yes, sir! Yes, sir! All praise is due to Allah. That mothership coming to rescue you all. Take you from this devil and destroy America. Yes, sir, praise be to Allah. I know it's the truth. Would be physically dead if that good white person hadn't come to your house and gave you some help. Every white person, living and dead, is the devil. Even those in the wombs of their mothers are devils. They are devils by nature and can't help themselves. Yes, sir! Praise be to Allah. I know it's the truth. Powerful magnetism. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said what his teacher told him to say, what Farad told him to say. The white race is a race of grafted devils. That's what he said. Said that black is original. Black man is God. Now, you know, we believe all of this in degrees. We accepted it wholly as a rhythm in our life. Or we accepted it wholly, or it's just a rhythm. It charges us, it sets us to a happy mood and a happy tune, you know, happy movement. That's how praise be to Allah. But up here, when we start thinking rationally, we backed up. All praise is due to Allah. All praise is due to Allah. In an attempt to get African Americans to think rationally, now listen very carefully. In an attempt to get African Americans, or black people as we call ourselves, to think rationally while studying religion or thinking about religion, religious language, religious terminology, Mr. Farrar told his followers, the unknown does not exist. That's what he said. The unknown does not exist. He said, we have searched for that unknown God. He used the term mystery. We have searched for that mystery God. for trillions and trillions of years. Now, that's mind-boggling right there. Trillions and trillions of years? Where in the hell is that history? Trillions and trillions of years. Saying we have come to the conclusion, they're saying we have been unable to find him. So we have come to the conclusion that there is no mystery God. That the only God is the Son of Man. That's what he said. Now, is that Islam? Mr. W. Farrar quietly placed within our view, within our eyes, within our view, mental view too, attractions such as pantheism. Many of you have never recognized the flavor of pantheism in the teachings of Farrar. He said that Allah is in the heavens and in the earth, but not unseen. That he is the all in all. That's pantheism. That's pantheism. Saying that all material reality is God. Pantheism. That everything in the realm of reality, taken together, taken all together, is God. Farrar also put in our way the attraction of materialism, a kind of Marxist materialism, by telling us that if it ain't material, it doesn't exist. If it ain't material, it doesn't exist. He also introduced to us the attraction of socialism. I don't know if you imams have found that. He said, what is social? He answers the question and answers it himself. He said, what is social? He said, social is to advocate a society of men, a group of men, for one common cause. And equality is to be equal in everything. Now, the question addresses socialism. But he asks equality. And equality means to be equal in everything. Now, how are you going to be equal in everything? If I would describe the genius of Farrar in one statement, I would say his genius was giving people the impossible and getting them to believe the impossible is more real than the possible. Oh, that man was powerful, powerful doctor of the psyche. Now, he also put as an attraction for us the worship of God in man, or man God. Now, we know the Honorable Elijah Muhammad told us that Mr. Farrar was God, God in the person, the son of his father who was God, that God is passed down from father to son. We know he told us that. But when you study Mr. Farrar's teachings, you see that Mr. Farrar points to himself as the Son of Man, the Son of Man. But he points to the black man as the man, the man, the man, the original man, the true God. And it is the black man that even gave birth to Farrar, the Son of Man. Here is the language. Said his father was a black man, 100% black man, by the name of Alfonso. No, it sounds like a joke to you now, but if you were back then, you would say, oh, hey, yes! I know it's the truth. said his mother was a white woman by the name of Baby G. Now, you know that sounds good to uneducated blacks. Baby G. Oh, Baby G. Yes, our Savior's mother was named Baby G. Saying she was 100% white woman. Yes, praise be to Allah. Every white person is the devil. Yes, praise be to Allah. Never see the conflict. Never see the contradiction. So attracted, the magnetism is so strong on your thoughts and your mind that you can't think, you can't see anything that make you differ with your teacher. Impossible for you to differ with your teacher. You know what does that? Hypnotism. If you have heard about hypnotism, let me tell you something about hypnotism. If a hypnotist gets a willing subject, a hypnotist can hypnotize a person and tell him to bite this mic, it's chocolate candy. And he will bite that mic and break out his teeth and keep doing it till the hypnotist stops him. This is fact. Hypnotists can take a man, a woman, or anybody that will submit to be the subject that he can hypnotize. Hypnotize them, tell them to put your arm out there, take fire and put up under there. Say, that's cool. Say, isn't that cool? Yes, yes. Because he has complete control of their mind. And that's what Farad did. He designed something to give him complete control of our minds. If we bought it. See, a hypnotist can't hypnotize you until you agree to it. Now, I'm not saying he was Satan, but the same thing for Satan. Allah teaches us with his holy book, the Quran, that Satan does not have power over you except what you give to Satan. You have to be willing. That's what it means. If you're not willing, Satan can't control you. Now, so why did Freud put these attractions in our way? Because he knew the time, and he was afraid of what could happen. Already there were intellectual blacks, a few of them turning to communism, to Marxism. He was afraid that his following may be taken over by Marxists, because he had gathered people who didn't care for America, who didn't care for the white man. He gathered those people who were fed up with America and felt that we don't have any hope here. They will never do anything just by us. So those were the people he gathered. So the same people now that he gathered could be attractive to Marxists. The Marxists will say, look, this is here, people already that don't have any faith in America. Let us go among them and make converts. Farad, suspecting that, he puts something in there to make you feel, oh, what are you telling us? When they come and tell us about socialism, say, oh, we don't want to hear it. We got freedom, justice, and equality. Islam is freedom, justice, and equality. And they say, well, do you know anything about socialism? Social means to advocate a society of men, a group of men for one common cause. And equality means to be equal in everything. You better join the Nation of Islam. Yeah. So you take an uneducated man and make him think he's the wisest man on earth, but it can't nobody teach him. That's a fact. You take a dummy and make him think he's the wisest creature on earth, ain't nobody can tell him anything until the hypnotic spell is broken. Now, I want to point out one powerful positive. Because he's experimenting with positives and negatives, right? So I pointed out a lot of negatives, but I pointed to one powerful positive. He said the Quran is the right book, not the Bible. Quran is a holy book. The Bible is a poison book. Now I'm going to point you to a second positive, powerful one. By telling us that we were once Muslims and we descended, we came from Muslim ancestors, and that we were once the best of the Muslims, he told us. By him telling us that, and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad being skilled, that's why he picked the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Because the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was a renegade, a rebel in Christianity. But a person that believed that that the Bible was right, but had to be read in a different way. So he picked the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was able, he knew his father preached that Bible, he knew it. He didn't have to study it in no school. Father preached it in the church at night and the day and at the dinner table. So the Honorable Elijah Muhammad knew all the stories. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad giving us the Bible story. And that's you. Don't look at these people. Don't look at the white race. That's not talking about them. That's talking about you. You are the ones that are in bondage. And you are the one that's long overdue for a deliverer. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I know it's the truth. And if anybody say I'm making fun, you're wrong. You're dead wrong. So because of the way we were sensitized and the kind of language environment that we were put in to sensitize us and set us to a rhythm of obedience, because of that, we came to firmly believe. Now, we believed, most of us believed before we became Muslims by that name, in that condition of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Most of us believed that God should have an interest in us as a people. Most of us believe that if there's any real God existing, that God should come to our rescue. Most of us believe that. So most of us believe that God didn't carry us through all this hell and damnation and torment and aggravation, vexation of our souls and demeaning of our human worth. We believe that God didn't do all that without a purpose. We believe that God had a cause, and he was preparing us for a cause. We believe that our life in America was for a purpose. Our suffering was for a purpose. God was fashioning us, influencing us, and shaping us to serve his cause, divine cause. When the Honorable Elijah, if we didn't think it consciously or dwell on it in our minds, that feeling was in our hearts and in our souls. So when the Honorable Elijah Muhammad came and said that you are his people and he has chosen you to make a nation, we believed it. And we began to identify with the divine cause. Now let me use Jonah, the prophet, upon him be peace, to explain to you how I see this, how I see our suffering. And yet believe that we have been chosen for a divine cause, to serve the divine cause, to be a people serving the divine cause. Jonah, in both the Quran and in the Bible, the stories are pretty much the same. The report in both books are pretty much the same. Jonah was a man who had a destiny with God. He had an appointment with God. But for some reason, he forgot it. He became negligent. He became absent-minded or something. And he finds himself on a boat out at sea. And the boat gets into trouble. Storm comes up. The boat is a commercial boat. It's carrying cargo. It's the boat of businessmen who are out there to make money. That's why they are at sea. They're at sea to carry goods to ports, make money, bring goods back from port. They got out there to make money. And Jonah, he's on this boat. He doesn't belong to those people. They find him down in the hull of the boat. They call it the belly of the boat. They find him down there, sleep. He's down there lying on the cargo, lying up on their money, sleep. So when it's reported to the masters of the ship, they said, go down and get him up. Say, maybe he is the jinx. Maybe he is the hoodoo, the voodoo on this trip of ours. They go out and bring him up. So when they brought him up, they didn't ask him any question. And he didn't say anything. They just threw him right overboard out there in the raging water. Threw him off their boat into the raging water. And as the story goes, along comes a big fish and swallows him up. Now, while he's in the belly of the big fish, he remembers that he was supposed to be doing something. That he was given an assignment. So he starts to feel bad because he didn't do his assignment. And just his repentant posture within himself brought God to come to his rescue. And God made the big fish aware that he had swallowed something very strange. Big fish wasn't conscious until God made the big fish conscious. When God made the big fish conscious, big fish said, what the hell is this strange thing that I have swallowed? It is most distasteful in my stomach. So he headed for the shore. He didn't even want that distasteful thing in the water where he lived or swim. He headed for the shore. When he got to the shore, he spit it out. Spit Jonah out on the shore. Jonah. Now, you may not accept this application of this story, but I'm going to give it to you. The white, rich world of America, they find you, who got a destiny with God, laying up sleeping comfortably on their wealth. Then what is this? And the economy gets into trouble. The waters that support their economy is raging. Say, is that what? Is that, hey, look at that. They done spooked the journey. They done spooked the journey. Throw them out. Boom. So they threw us out of slavery, right? Threw us out of slavery. Go on your own. You can have 40 acres and a mule, but you're getting off this boat. And wasn't it the slave economy that was supporting our existence? The whole existence of our people in slavery was supported by slave economy? Okay, then throw them off this boat, throw you off the boat. And here come the big church in the name of the Lord, Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. And now they burn in black churches. Big fish came, swallowed you up. But a few of us remembered that we had further to go than the belly of the whale.
Yes.
Go ahead. See, we got a destiny. We got a divine destiny. Church rejected us. Church rejected us. And then Farad came and said, they don't want you. Nobody wants you but me. I'm your only savior. But right now I want you to study your situation on the sand. Study sand. Out there on the seashore. Spit Jonah up out on the sand. On the bank of the sea, Joe. Oh yeah. Study sand until you discover what I want you to find. Sand. Not bad in life. Study sand. Right? Yeah. So standing up out there so pitiful and meaning well now and ready to serve God, really want to serve God now. He wanna answer that call. God have mercy on him. Cause a little gourd plant to grow up on his body and shade his head out there on the sand. Sand means the absence of culture, the absence of civilized society. You're away from it. The absence of knowledge. You're away from it. Out there on the sand. But having good intentions and now want to be right with God. So God had mercy and caused some life to come up on out of the sand. A gourd plant, so it is given in the Quran, comes up, a vine wraps itself around and shades your head. A bit of mercy. Hmm? And in the story, Jonah said, I got a 3-day journey. He meant, I can't stay in this situation. I got a 3-day journey. Meaning the urge inside the human being will never be satisfied until the human being has a comfortable environment and a comfortable state to live in. Something that he feels good about. Can't feel good about that kind of existence. And that's how we've been moved. From bad situation to another situation, from a bad situation to a better situation, or trying to move to a better situation, because something inside us tells us that we don't yet have a comfortable situation for ourselves. Now we in America, the law has been changed from 2 laws to 1 law for all citizens. We're not fearing the Klan gonna march on us or drag us out of the houses at night or something. That's gone. We live in a changed America, greatly changed. But too many of us are still feeling hopeless. We still feel like we are oppressed. We still feel like we are being dominated and that we are not in charge of our own circumstances, that the white man controls our circumstances. Too many of us feel that way. And that's why Minister Farrakhan, a man that I like him, and he's tough now. He's hypnotic, no doubt about it. Can hold an audience spellbound. But that's why he's able to continue to give that same message that I have grown out of. He's able to give that same message to many of our young African-American men, youth, because their fathers can't tell them anything. Their fathers can't direct them, can't give them any guidance. Whether they're in the church or not, their fathers and their mothers can't direct them, can't give them any guidance. No guidance that they can accept. If they tell them, go to school, that ain't enough. Say, go to school and you'll be able to get you a good job, that ain't enough. If they tell them, get a good job and work and save your money, that ain't enough for most of those youngsters out there today. Because the good job that brings them money quick is a bad job, it's an illegal job, selling drugs, etc. So they can't reach them, and there those youngsters are can't be reached by their mothers and fathers, by their family, and by the church leaders, the black church leaders. They can't be reached. And they're feeling hopeless inside. They're feeling like, I'm supposed to have better than this on this earth. Something should be done about this situation. So Farrakhan comes and condemns the whole system, the whole establishment, and they listen. They come under the hypnotic spell. We shouldn't condemn them. We should sympathize with them and understand them. And pray to Allah that we, who don't need that anymore, we feel free in our souls. We don't feel oppressed. We feel that we can take our own circumstances into our own hands. We should pray to Allah that He bless us more to become more learned Muslims and more qualified Muslims so we can have a stronger and more rational and more convincing argument, but also a better material presence, a better material existence to convince Farrakhan and those who follow him that they do have hope in America. There is hope in America. My study of Islam, my study of the Quran, and the leadership of the perfect human being that God has given us, complete in his human nature and makeup, Muhammad the Prophet, tells me that God created every human being for a great station of honor. Great station of honor. Now, most of us won't qualify, not separately or individually. But God has made it so that among us will always be leaders that excel. And these leaders can lead us to that great situation, to that ideal situation that Allah wants for our lives. And we can all together share in it and identify with it and feel that we in some way made a contribution toward it. We made it possible by supporting our leader or supporting the idea. Therefore, we all can come into good establishment. Allah created us for good establishment, and He wants us to come into good establishment. And until our souls find ourselves in good establishment, we are going to feel denied, cheated, somewhat oppressed. But when we ever are convinced in our rational minds that we are on the road toward the good establishment, if we are convinced, no more oppression in the soul, no more hopelessness, freedom, jubilation, enthusiasm, positive posture, confident work. Yes. Now, thank Allah, I and a big number of you, we have made it because of God's forgiveness and His mercy to us. Allahu Akbar. So we are moving forward. We are not Jonah in the boat anymore, sleeping. We are not Jonah on the sandy seashore anymore, trying to pretend that a little gourd plant is really a whole world. No, we are not in that situation. We are moving forward. We are moving forward with our human resources and with our small material resources. Before, it was just made the emphasis was on our human resources. Let your humanity, let your best human nature rise up and kiss the Quran. Rise up and kiss Muhammad. Rise up and embrace Islam and be happy. So we preached that for about 20 years. Yes? But now we are saying, as Allah says, struggle in the path of God with both your human resources and your material resources. That's what God says to us in the Quran. So now we're at that point when we can invite all of you to make this mighty jihad, this mighty struggle, with our human souls and its resources, intellect and everything, and with our material possessions, no matter how small they are. Let us bring our material possessions and our human possessions into the path of God, to make progress in the path of God, both spiritual progress and material progress. That's my invitation to you that I've been given now for about a year or so or more, maybe 2 years or more. And you're responding. We are not giving up on help from outside, assistance, financial assistance from the outside. We're not giving up on that. But we are not making that our main concern. We are making our own resources and our own industry in our own nature. God has made man industrious. He has given him industry in his own nature, and your soul is your industry. So God wants us to be industrious people, and relying upon our own industrious nature to bring us material results. We're going to seek business in a big way, not in a small way. We're going to seek business in a big way. We are not going to the bottom to get to the top. We are going to the top to bring up the bottom. And with our numbers, we don't have to start on the bottom. Long ago, leaders even before black nationalists, and even before the black nationalists, there were African Americans or Africans in America who were telling their people that we can lift our own selves up materially. All we have to do is support each other, cooperate with each other. Along comes Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and he makes a lot of progress calling us to self-help, to accept to help yourselves, cooperate with each other, combine your efforts and your resources. He said, pool your monies. He made a real big showing for us, and we made a real big showing for that belief, for that idea. We did. We impressed a lot of people. We never were an empire, though. Don't believe that hoodwinking bull. $4 million in the bank, how is that an empire? You can't hardly buy a decent jet with that kind of money. But we were told by, not by us, Honorable Elijah Muhammad ain't never told us we were an empire. It was a white man, the devilish, deceitful white man, in his press, trying to get us to think, oh, look how big you became in America. White man uses some powerful psychology. And notice I said the devilish, deceitful white man. Not all of them. The few among them that's really wicked. Look what they did to the American Indian. Came over here and made the American Indians think that they had nations too. White man come over here and just take everything away from them, their land and everything, and put them under the trees and tents. Camping on the river and stuff, and tell them, you the Sioux Nation. You the Seahawks Nation.
Start calling them nations. Went to their head.
I represent the Sioux Nation.
Call the leaders
honorable.
Honorable Marcus Garvey. Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Honorable. Leader of the Nation of Islam.
Then when he dies,
the man that built an empire.
Thinking, oh, empire, that's a whole lot of money. God Almighty. Bill Cosby, in his money that his money makes without him looking at it, had more than the whole Nation of Islam had when the Honorable Elijah Muhammad died. Bill Cosby, one man, one African-American man. Not to mention his wife's money, too. They say he's going to make, I think, $40 million in 1 year, his new assignment, his new show for CBS. I think they say $40 million. You couldn't find $40 million nowhere when the Honorable Elijah Muhammad passed. He's going to make that in 1 year. So don't let your enemy capture your mind and manipulate your mind to his advantage. Never look at yourself through the eyes of your enemy. Never estimate yourself as your enemy estimates you. If he say you are great people, don't listen to him. Look at yourself and see if it's true. Say, oh, your leader of confidence, this, he's rich, he built an empire. Don't be influenced by him. Don't be duped by him. Study what your leader did and see if that's an empire. But you know, we believed it. We were so hypnotized that we actually believed it. Read in the paper, Chicago Tribune, New York Times, the Nation of Islam, Honorable Elijah Muhammad built an empire. Rockefeller, he built an empire. Yes, Mr. Rockefeller. Did you all tour the Rockefeller Center with a crowd out? Visit, that man was something else. That man had so much money, he had bought an island. Come to the island, people on it, he said, how much is this island? I don't know, no, we don't know. Get a price. Figure the price. The price, okay, this is my island now. Rockefeller did that. And he just won in a powerful family of Rockefellers. One in a powerful family of Rockefellers. Now, that's wealth. Those big, rich Rockefellers, they built an empire. They did have a financial empire. Now, I think that's awful wicked of the white press to tell us who follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad built an empire. That's to turn us crazily in favor of him or either crazily against him. Hey, all that man had all that money, we ain't got nothing. Or either to make you, if you're still hypnotized, to make you stay in that. Yeah, brother, even the white man recognized our leader, what he was able to do, brother. So let's stop saying we're a nation. We're a tribe. A lot of small tribes. And we're in a nation. You want to really become part of a nation, then bring your small tribe and join the 1 billion Muslims on this earth. Then you'll be in the nation. You'll be in the Nation of Islam. You'll be in the Ummah of Al-Islam, in the community of Al-Islam, the international community of Al-Islam. Now, and concluding this, and lastly, I want to have a few words with you on our economic plan. But in concluding this, I'm going back and say something to you about the mothership. Oh, yes, yes, it's important. Now, what is the interpretation of this mothership? The interpretation of this mothership is the world order that Farad created. He made us believe that we belong to our own world. He gave us our own language. The outside world couldn't buy our language or understand it. So he created a world for us. And our world is like a mothership. It's out of touch with this world. It's suspended above this world. And we really feel we're above this world. And on that world, we don't eat, we don't drink, we don't defecate. We don't urine. No activity whatsoever, but still we're existing. No life activity, but we existed. Even managing to steer the ship. But every now and then, we realize we need something downstairs or something in the real world to survive. So we throw out a tube, and we drop that tube down in the atmosphere of the real world so we can keep breathing. But as soon as we got the breath to just keep our life, we draw this tube back into the ship, and we say, we don't need anything from this devil's world. Now, that ship is also a ship that is time to go to war. It's going to go to war one day. But for the time being, it's restricted to stay out of touch with this world, its life, its atmosphere. It's restricted. But one day, it's going to come down into this world's atmosphere. And when it does, it's going to be at war. Going to send out 1,500 bombing planes. Yeah, 1,500. 1,500 bombing planes with three bombs carried by each plane. And with a drill on each bomb that automatically starts drilling. Soon as it strikes the earth, and it drills, takes the bomb into the earth a mile deep. Time not to explode until it gets 1 mile deep. Then it's going to explode and throw up the ground, the earth, 1 mile high. Going to make 1 mile high mountains. Each plane carrying three bombs. Each bomb with a drill. Now, that's some complicated, very, very complicated abstract reasoning. So I'm almost in a situation where it's impossible for me to satisfy your understanding completely. So I'm just going to give you the general idea, the general picture. Once we break the spell with Farad, and we come down here with our rational minds open and start dealing in this world or come in touch with its atmosphere, you know, you breathe, right? First breath the child takes, his mind is alert. Mind becomes conscious, right? So it means it's symbolic. It's language that you have to understand. It has to be interpreted. So you come down in this atmosphere. Now you're going to have to breathe this atmosphere. When you breathe this atmosphere, you're gonna become conscious. Conscious. And the spell is gonna be broken. You're not, the Farad ain't gonna be holding you anymore. Now you're thinking independently on your own. Now, if you start thinking independently on your own from Farad, after breaking the spell with Farad, you're gonna make hell and trouble for the white man. The zebras did it. The 5%ers did it. They made hell because they start thinking on their own. So they start dropping bombs. Throwing up little hills a mile high. Then the last thing gonna happen is a shortage gonna be made in the gravity and set all the atmosphere afire. These crazy blacks, these extreme blacks, breaking the hypnotic spell with fraud. Oh man, they set the atmosphere of America afire. Brought the Klan back out. Yeah. Extremists on both sides, black and white, still haven't stopped. You tell me some of the skinflint heads are still around, aren't they? I think so. I don't think they gave up their mission yet. They should, but I don't think they have. Yeah, so all of this fire just comes into the atmosphere. Anger, rage. That's what it means by fire. So in the atmosphere of our minds, in the atmosphere of our thinking, there's nothing but rage and violence and fire and attacking and condemning, burning passions, setting the whole environment of man's mind and thoughts afire. So much so to now, the preacher that has the answer comes with cool water for hot times, is looked upon as a traitor. Oh, he's a traitor. He's a turncoat. He ain't angry. He ain't hating nobody. Oh, that's a traitor. That's a turncoat. So I think, Mr. Farrar, if we can translate or interpretate his abstract reasoning, I think we will see his genius. We will see his genius. And we will see that he planned something and knew what would follow. Man plans something mysterious, and he puts it into the environment of American people. He knows eventually it's going to affect black people, and he put it together, so he knows how it's going to affect black people. He put it together, so he also knows how it's going to affect white people. So he predicts what's going to happen, and he predicted it correct. He predicted it correctly. But this man also had a prayer that some of those who accepted him would one day believe that he did have a scheme, but he also had a love and an appreciation for the Quran, and he wanted the people who identified or came to him, if it was possible, to one day be real Muslims. So that's his prayer. That's the prayer he prayed. So because of that, it worked. God rewards all good and punishes all evil. But he rewards all good. So because of that, it worked for a few of us. It brought us to be skeptical, to be suspicious of his language and of what he's saying on the surface. But at the same time, to wonder why he wanted us to have the Quran. To wonder why he said it was a perfect book, the holy book, God's book. Right. It made us wonder why. So we're believing that we shouldn't just dismiss this man as a complete wrongdoer, but we should have patience with him. Maybe he's saying something else under the surface of his language. And God blessed the son of Elijah Muhammad, Wallace D. Muhammad, to make the interpretation. And I'm telling you that the scheme has worked. It has worked to set us against the white man. It has worked to bring us to Islam. Thank you very much. Now let's talk about our economic plan. Well, I think some of us said that getting an African American or black man to come to the Nation of Islam, who's well off in this white man world, is almost impossible. We said that, didn't we? And Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, don't even try to get them. Don't go to them. Say they will never accept. But go to that one that's down in the mud. That's what he told us. Yeah. So if you really understand what I have given you, you shouldn't be angry with me, and you shouldn't be angry with Honorable Elijah Muhammad. You shouldn't be angry with Mr. Farad. You should just be thankful to God.